Good afternoon. Good afternoon to everyone. This is a very exciting moment which needs a little bit of quiet. So thank you so much for being here. This is a celebration and a reflection, which is what it should be. 20 years is not much time in the life of most universities. It's just a blip in time. But for us, it's an entire lifetime. The lifetime of CEU is measured within these 20 years. It's a time when we're not yet as old as any of our students. And yet, I think it's time for us to celebrate that we are growing up, maybe that we have grown up. The founding of CEU, as you know, in 1991, was at a time of great transition in this region and beyond. And I always like to say that CEU was conceived in a very sort of slightly exciting moment in that respect of about the interaction of an idea, a great idea, and a great promise. The idea, of course, is that the university that was being founded could become a laboratory for open society. And the promise was that faculty and students from the region, and we weren't at that stage dreaming beyond, could come to create that laboratory. The idea and the promise came from CEU's founders. These were the intellectual and political leaders of Central European transition. They were very brave and bold. We know who many of them are and were, and we are, of course, most fortunate to have as our keynote speaker today at this conference our founder, George Soros. And I am not here to introduce George, but to introduce Leon Botstein, who is the chairman of the CEU board, who will indeed introduce George Soros. Leon, as many of you know, is an educational pioneer himself, president of Bard College. He's also a distinguished conductor and music director of the American Symphony Orchestra, and we'll have a chance to hear him this evening. So without further ado, Leon, over to you.
Thank you, John. It's an unenviable position to welcome you all on behalf of the board of the Central European University and to introduce George Soros, who is an individual who genuinely requires no introduction. I do want to say just four very brief things. First, the university was founded at a time which is greatly different from the one we find ourselves in today, and was built on many assumptions. One of Mr. Soros's initial ideas was that philanthropy and intervention would be in response to a historical moment and not necessarily end up in creating institutions that would transcend the shift in history. The original years of the CEU, and I see several rectors here from the original moments, was funded on an annual basis, had no endowment. There was no real notion that you would build an institution in the traditional sense. But times change and circumstances change. And 20 years later, the university has a fabulous campus, which will expand in the center of the city, has an endowment, a distinguished faculty, a thriving student body. It is an institution, a university. But it wants to be a different kind of university, and that reflects the vision of its founder. The second thing is that it was originally going to be a university in many places. But Mr. Soros, as you know, is a native of Budapest. And I remember vividly in the 10th anniversary of the Hungarian Foundation, a big celebration in the National Gallery. And I was reminded the enormous contribution he has made to this country in the last 25, almost 30 years. So it is through a set of circumstances that a campus in Warsaw, a campus in Prague, never really took root, and the university became centralized here in Mr. Soros' native city. And the final thing I'd like to say is that the founder is himself a man of ideas, who's written a large number of books. Some are very technical on the nature of markets, some philosophical, and to many political. He founded a university without actually being of a university, but with an outsider's public intellectual view of how universities have fallen short, as well as what they can contribute to the notion of open society. The irony is, we celebrate now the founding of this university when the first students will come who did not live under communism from this region. It's the first completely post-Soviet generation will enroll in this university, where there is no memory of why this university was founded in the first place. Without further ado, George Soros.
Thank you. Well, since this is the 20th anniversary of the university, it would be a wonderful occasion to establish the official history of the first 20 years, to create sort of carve into stone the institutional memory of those years. But I'm not the right person to do it because I have I'm notorious for having a bad memory, and even when I'm in the present, I pay very little attention to detail. My excuse is that I only remember the future. So what I can do is to give you my vision for the university and how it has evolved in the course of the 20 years. And it has, in fact, evolved an awful lot. And in fact, as I'll describe it, I kind of made a full circle. The idea of the university was first mooted at the Dubrovnik Inter-University Center, which I was supporting, sometime around 1989. And as I recall it, it was proposed by a distinguished historian, Peter Hanak. And I reacted to it very negatively because I didn't believe in institution buildings. In my view, all institutions are flawed, and I was much more engaged at the time in demolishing institutions than in building them. And I basically had a kind of a subversive attitude towards institutions, trying to infuse the existing institutions with a different spirit. And I did it successfully in Hungary, less successfully in South Africa. But my attitude basically was a negative one. Then, after the fall of the Berlin Wall, I changed my mind because I felt that we were in the midst of an unfinished revolution where the Soviet system, the closed society of the Soviet system collapsed, but the transition to an open society was incomplete, and that there was a need for an institution to embody the revolutionary spirit of the collapse of the Soviet Union. And also I felt that there was a need for an academic institution because the meaning of the transformation that was occurring was not properly understood. Most people saw it as a transition from communism to capitalism. The idea of transition from closed society to open society was much less well recognized. And I also thought that this new institution could serve as the brain center for this network of foundations that I was establishing throughout the former Soviet Empire. That network was engaged in doing, and I thought that there was also a need for thinking. I also had some great ambitions for reforming the social sciences, recognizing reflexivity and complexity. And I wanted to create a home for evolutionary systems theory, which would have applications to economics and environmental sciences. Something similar to what was the, I think, at the same time formed Santa Fe Institute. Now, some of these ideas were quite impractical because, for one thing, a university must jealously safeguard its academic independence. Therefore, it couldn't serve as the brain center for a foundation network. And secondly, a newly established university tends to seek academic respectability and recognition, and therefore it tends to be a rather inhospitable towards heretic ideas like evolutionary systems theory. And I had other impractical ideas. I wanted to establish the university in at least three locations, Budapest, Prague, and Warsaw, so that it should be truly international. And I also wanted the university to actually start in Prague rather than Budapest, because being Hungarian, and if the university started in Budapest, it would inevitably become a Hungarian university instead of being a truly international one. And finally, to take advantage of the revolutionary moment, we started without any plans. To take advantage of the, because I believed that in revolutionary times, the impossible becomes possible, and therefore it's possible to start without a plan. So the result of this was what I would call a fertile fallacy. An institution with plenty of flaws, which can make, however, important progress by correcting those flaws. And this, in fact, what we were doing, and in this way, the university fulfilled my vision of an institution that was embodying the spirit of the unfinished revolution of 1989. The decision to establish the university was taken at a meeting in Oxford in December 1990, and actual courses began in Prague in September 91. That was very quick indeed, and it was one of our proud accomplishments that we started without academic accreditation, but we obtained accreditation in retrospect. So even the students who participated in the first year actually graduated with a degree recognized in the United States. That was actually Leon Botstein's contribution to the university, as I remember. So we started in Prague in a building donated by the Prague government, which gave us the headquarters of the defunct trade union congress. But we got no title to the building. And as the government in the Czech Republic under Václav Klaus was formed, he turned out to be quite hostile. In fact, more than quite, he was very hostile to the university. It took me a long time to discover why, but that was the case. And a couple of years later, we lost possession of the university, of the building, and we actually had to move to another building, and then eventually we shut down Prague campus. We started in Budapest in the following year in temporary quarters because I didn't particularly believe in buildings, but I was more concerned with what goes on inside the buildings. That was another a fallacious idea that I had, because eventually we did buy a building, and it was developed in a very imaginative way, and I think having that building is a very important element in giving the university its home and its the ambiance in which it functions. And then we also established a branch in Warsaw, this sociology, which went on for several years. In Prague, we started with three faculties under the and the university itself was under the direction of Bill Newton Smith. But I took a very active role in that, and so it was quite confused, and I would call it amateur hour. which had its advantages and disadvantages. What I would call the revolutionary period, ended in 95 when the new and rebuilt university building in Budapest was opened, and Al Stepan became the president of the university. To sum up this revolutionary period, I would point out the advantages, namely that being the first and only institution of its kind, we did attract the best talents from the region. And the student body was really world class. And it attracted also visiting professors, world class leading intellectuals from the West who came to visit. We also could gather the leading lights in the region. We had Ernest Gellner in Prague, who returned from Cambridge, and we had Thierry Musil, who was local in Prague, and then in Budapest we had János Kiss, András Sajó, István Rév, János Klanicai, just to mention some of the outstanding people. The main drawback was that since we started without a plan and established one faculty after another when a suitable leader emerged, the university was really a collection of fiefdoms rather than an integrated whole. And the other major disadvantage was my personal participation in the active development of the university. So by the end of this revolutionary period, I recognized these deficiencies, and I stopped interfering in the running of the university, and I allowed the university to develop independently. And that is, in fact, what happened in the remainder of the last 20 years. And the CEU developed from a regional into a global institution with students from over 100 countries and faculty from over 40, and achieving considerable academic excellence. So it can be deemed to be a success, I think, proudly say that. But conditions changed. Hungary joined the European Union. The European Union reformed higher education, and the state-run university system is now offering students a much greater mobility. So the opportunities before students are much broader than they were at the time when we established the university. And as the sponsor of a private university, I find myself competing with the European state-run system. And as a sponsor and funder, I have to question whether it is really the best use of my money to have a university, even if it has achieved academic excellence, whether it is worthwhile competing with what the state system is offering. So there's a danger, as I see it, of the CEU becoming the opposite of a fertile fallacy, a sterile success. And to overcome this, I have developed a new vision for the university, which is actually the same vision that led me to establish it, which is that the university should be something unique, that it should be innovative, it should offer something that other universities don't offer. And that is my vision for the university, and I think that the university is now in a better position to actually deliver on this vision than it was 20 years ago. because it is now academically established. And so it is mature enough to be a trailblazer in the social sciences. And it has, in fact, begun to be so. We have a center for network theory. We are, I think, becoming a leading institution in network theory, in cognitive science. And there is the Institute for New Economic Thinking, INET. And at least two of these, the cognitive science and INET, has received research grants from the European Union. So I think that is the demonstration that we are, in fact, now at the cutting edge. And the centerpiece, as far as my vision is concerned, is the School of Public Policy, which we are embarking on next fall, which will combine the theoretical thinking of a university with the practical experience of the foundation network. So, the network of networks that the foundation has established. The School of Public Policy will be able to do what the university itself should not do, that it can in fact become the brain center for the foundation network. And as a counterpoint to the School of Public Policy, we are rejuvenating, reinventing the business school, which has been the least successful element in the university. We will be starting with an entrepreneurship course, because I believe that having a student body of people who are interested in making money will be an excellent counterpoint for the student body in the School of Public Policy that is interested in making policy. I have really great hopes and great expectations for the Central European University. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Thank you, George, for instilling in us again the revolutionary spirit that you brought about and took advantage of and indeed instilled at the very beginning of this university. I think this is a very special moment when we've heard from the founder who I would not compare him to Chairman Mao, but shall we say, there is now a new spirit of going forth into the world with the various mature elements of this university, and once again stirring the pot as we do so academically, intellectually, and by connecting theory and practice. So I thank you again, George, for your inspiration, the creation of this university, and now, in many respects, the recreation of the university. We are joined here today by the, as George has already said, by the previous rectors, my predecessors, and you'll hear from them in a few moments. But let me first just reflect on the circumstances in which this new spirit, shall we say, of innovation and new development at the university is going on. The circumstances in the world are quite different from what they were in 1991. The open society challenge is everywhere. That is to say, there was plenty of challenge at the time, but it nonetheless seemed to be an endless process of opening things up and developing further democracy, human rights, and transparency, even under very difficult circumstances. But today, the circumstances are very different and very difficult, and we see the contest over open society all around us, the erosion in many places of democracy and human rights, the resurgence of ethnic and religious conflict, the struggle over resources and the rise of nationalism and authoritarianism in this region and beyond. At the same time, there are extraordinary external opportunities that are in some ways comparable to those that existed in the founding of the university. The popular movements against repressive governments across the Arab and Islamic world is certainly the most visible aspect of that, and I think more general is the growing evidence that civil society is having an influence over the developments in public policy, and in many respects, governments are being more influenced or can be more influenced today than they could be before by civil society because of new tools that are available, whether it's the social media and the internet or simply the extraordinary development of cross-border and transnational communications. So, with that in mind, there is plenty for what I call an open society university to do, and plenty of opportunities for new initiatives of the kind that George has spoken about. Let me just say a few more words about some of these elements that are now very actively at the center of CEU's agenda as we enter our third decade. Certainly at the most visible and largest aspect of this is the creation of the School of Public Policy and International Affairs, which will bring together parts of the faculty and what will make it unique, I think, among similar schools elsewhere in the world is that it will focus particularly on what I just mentioned, which is the increasing influence of civil society, both positive and negative, on the development of public policy. And in that respect, it will work closely with the Open Society Foundations, which are, in a sense, the sister organizations of CEU. And we're very pleased now to have a new dean, Wolfgang Reinecke, who is here today to lead that effort starting in the fall. The development of a Center for Network Science will be a very exciting aspect, interdisciplinary, of CEU, which will draw together social sciences and the physical sciences in a world that is full of networks and the networks that need to be understood. And we have a number of leaders in that field. We're getting great help from Laszlo Barabasi, who's the new part-time professor at CEU and is also here with us today. The Center for Eastern Mediterranean Studies and Ottoman Studies. We're looking at the whole issue of deep history further to the east and away from the more rather traditional ways in which Western European and American universities have looked at, particularly at medieval studies, while building on the strength of our department in Central Europe. An Institute for New Economic Thinking, which is coming out of the challenges that the global economic crisis have posed to the whole field of economics, and in which George himself has been, in many respects, the central player in developing this institute. The Department of Cognitive Sciences, and most likely a new center for conflict and genocide studies, which are, in many respects, the central negative features of cross-border and internal conflict issues today. We have a university that is very international. Students drawn from 134 countries, 100 countries represented among the student body. An increasingly selective university, only 10% of those who apply are admitted. and a university that proudly carries the banner of equity and equal access by providing scholarships to students from across the world, and that provides opportunities for many needy students who wouldn't otherwise be able to enter graduate studies. And an outstanding faculty drawn from 40 countries, which has increasingly been recognized in many, many areas of academic excellence. But academic excellence, which is also inspired by the values and central features of a university, which are quite different from more traditional universities, as you've heard. Now, the remainder of this conference is going to be to essentially explore what's happened externally over these last two decades and the circumstances that we will be looking at that are going to influence the next decade of CEU's growth. What are the lessons learned and dangers to be avoided in the political and social transformations in Central and Eastern Europe and beyond? Issues of discrimination, pressures on the rule of law, weakness of checks and balances. These are issues that, of course, externally are going to be very important in the next decade of our work as we seek to address them. The speakers will go from Central Europe to the greater region to the world, and we have two distinguished panels, one that I'm going to turn in a moment to my colleague, the provost of CEU, Katalin Farkas, to introduce, and the second that I will introduce, a panel of the former rectors. So let me now turn to our professor of philosophy and provost of CEU. I should say a plug for the philosophy department. It was just named, I think, one of the 100 top departments in the world by one of those surveys that you pay no attention to until you're on it in the right way. So congratulations to the philosophy department. Kati is a specialist in the philosophy of mind, a great admirer of Descartes, about whom she has written extensively. In addition to CEU, she's taught at the University of Stockholm and universities of Sydney and Canberra. So, Kati, over to you.
Thank you very much. The dynamics of this event is that we are introducing people who are introducing people, because my role here is mainly to introduce the next part of this event, where three of our distinguished guests are going to talk about the meaning of open society. I think it's an interesting point to remember or recall. John was mentioning that open society faced certain challenges when the university was founded, and perhaps it's facing even more challenges today, that the very idea of open society, I think, was presented first as a contested idea, because when you think about the title of Popper's book, where he first presented the idea, it's called The Open Society and Its Enemies. And these enemies, I regret to say, were mainly my colleagues, that is, philosophers, Plato and Marx and Hegel. And I need to add that Popper himself was a philosopher too, so we're not all bad. I think actually the understanding of open society from the very beginning was shaped by an understanding of what challenges open society, the notion of open society, face. And we are very lucky here to have here three people to talk about this and other issues related to open society. They are each going to give a presentation on various aspects of this issue, and then perhaps we will have a reflection on each other's thoughts. So let me introduce the first speaker, Wanda Rapaczynski, who is a member of the Board of Trustees of CEU and chairs its Audit Committee. She's considered to be one of the most influential women in the world of business. After working for Citibank in the US as vice president and head of new product development, she returned to Poland in 1992 to become one of the creators of the Free Independent Polish Press. She has turned the Gazeta Wyborcza, the first legal and independent daily newspaper established in the Eastern Bloc, into one of the largest opinion-forming newspapers in Poland. Between 1998 and 2007, she also served as the president of Agora, the newspaper's parent company, which became one of the biggest Polish multimedia corporations. Wanda has received several awards and distinctions, and she's also a member of the advisory board of the Center for European Reform, an independent think tank devoted to the future of the European Union. Wanda.
Thank you very much for this very flattering introduction. This is a happy occasion. I'm extremely honored to be here with you today and extremely pleased to celebrate the 20th birthday of this university with you. My best wishes, my congratulations on your past achievements to the entire community. Thank you, the founder, and the best of luck for the future, the best wishes for the future accomplishments. And now at the risk of spoiling the festive mood, I would like to offer, we're asked to reflect by John. So I would like to reflect on the unfinished transformation in Central Europe and what it says about sustainability of democracy and broadening of democratic space. The experience of our region is, after the fall of communism, is now recalled in the context of the so-called Arab Spring. But it's important to remember that in the majority of countries in the post-communist space, regime changes were actually not followed by solid transformational successes. As to the minority of countries where it did, you know, we could ask this question, why did we, Poland, Hungary, Czech Republic, how did we get lucky? How did we manage to weather the political and economic storm of the early years and actually come out ahead? And of course, there are lots of reasons. I'd like to single out a few of them. I think that number one, a common denominator was that our countries had a tradition of civil society and democratic opposition. Democratic opposition actually gave us leaders, public-minded leaders, who were prepared to take on the labor and the risk of fundamental reforms. So that's one. Two, at least in Poland, of which I can speak knowledgeably, strong free media played an important role. They supported the reform agenda. They minutely, on daily basis, scrutinized the form and progress of transformation, and they helped people understand and adapt to changes that transformation brought, which were revolutionary fundamental changes. The third, and to my thinking, the most important role was played by our aspiration to join NATO and the EU. This was a matter of national dignity, of returning to our place in Europe, community of nations, et cetera, et cetera. It was a shared aspiration of the people and of all the sides or segments of the political spectrum. Now, we all remember that it took a few years of pushing, but eventually the door to the EU opened. We were given a chance, but to make use of this chance, of this opportunity, we actually had to meet very strict entry criteria, very strict requirements. This meant, in effect, that we had to carry out reforms in accordance with the EU's guidelines and EU's deadlines. And this was good, since our hearts were really set on becoming members, were set on this goal of returning to the European community. In effect, in this phase, we made tremendous progress in putting in place the fundamentals of liberal democratic states. Now, in hindsight, I look at this pre-accession phase as a phase of sponsored transformation, something we did not do entirely on our own. I also think of it as an unfinished transformation. Why is it incomplete? A couple of reasons. First, once the pressure of the beauty contest, the pressure of candidacy was off, the pace of reforms really fizzled out. And second, because in Poland we had peace, the law and justice government, and here in Hungary now you have the Orban government. To me, these two represent setbacks. Why? Because it tells me that the demons of the history of the past are still alive, that they can be used for political ends, that we somehow give to this temptation to flee freedom, give in to the pool of ethnic nationalism, authoritarian solutions. In short, that the model of liberal democracy in our region has not been fixed once and forever. It can change. The Kaczyński and Orban governments, to me, also suggest that the revolution is at risk of restoration, of reverting to some sort of semi-authoritarian or authoritarian rule, of squandering the achievements of transformation. And that also means a risk of marginalization on the international and European scene and return to the periphery, all those early hopes being dashed. Now, as many of my colleagues in the EU, I too very much counted on our countries assuming a significant role in the EU. I counted on our bringing new energy and new ideas to the European project. We all know that even before the economic crisis, the EU was beginning to lose a bit of a momentum. Its peace in Europe narrative was beginning to lose its firepower. I mean, what young person in Western Europe today treats seriously the risk of war between France and Germany? I don't think you would find anybody. And with so many more countries coming in, the core values of the EU were less salient, shall we say, than its processes and procedures. So I was hoping that because of our democratization experience, we would reinvigorate the EU's core of liberal democratic values, and that through the EU we would be instrumental in broadening the sphere of democracy to our eastern neighbors. Today, my friends, erstwhile dissidents in Poland, in Hungary, look at the political scene in our region with profound anxiety. And I have to say that to a large extent, I share their concern. Now, I don't think there is a serious danger that the free market model would be abandoned, because on the whole, it serves people here quite well. Though, and we are already seeing some of that, it can be subverted by bad policies and it can be subverted by political patronage. I am more concerned about what I call the trimming of democracy, about the model of liberal democracy being abandoned in favor of some kind of a mix of free market and authoritarian rule. Because it now seems that capitalism and liberal democracy may not be, as we believed at the beginning of the transformation, they may not be inextricably and causally intertwined. Maybe they can be divorced from one another. So, really, that leaves me with, as I told you, I was going to spoil your festive mood, it leaves me with some very fundamental questions here. Who will safeguard and defend values of liberal democracy when the EU is immersed in the economic crisis, when people are very angry and open to authoritarian alternatives, and when our countries, which for decades longed for these liberties and fought for them, are at the risk of slippage. Now, last comment, and I'm sticking to my 7 minutes, John. And as to the Arab countries, again, there are a lot of forces at work, a lot of scenarios, and a lot of possible choices each country could make. But to choose the model of liberal democracy and stick to the choice through the throes of transformation, these countries will need attractive models to follow and strong and open, in every sense of the word open, partners to support the process. Now, we in Central Europe had both. The question is, can we offer both? Thank you.
Thank you very much, Wanda. Our next speaker is Ivan Krastev. Ivan Krastev is a political scientist, an outstanding academic, and an advocate of democratic change and open societies in Eastern and Southeastern Europe. He's currently member of the OSF board and visiting professor at CEU's Legal Studies Department. He also serves as the chairman of the board of the Center for Liberal Strategies, an independent policy research institute in Sofia, and he's permanent fellow at the Institute of Human Sciences in Vienna. He's editor-in-chief of the Bulgarian edition of Foreign Policy and founding board member of the European Council of Foreign Relations, member of the Council of the International Institute for Strategic Studies in London. Ivan.
Thank you very much, and first of all, allow me to congratulate you all from the perspective of somebody who never was really a professor here and never was a student, but who represents a very important group of people who are neither in or out, but they're very much around the university. And I do believe that this group of people who are around is a very important group. All these think tankers from the region, they have been seen as the CEU, as the intellectual center through which they can have some of their debates. And from this point of view, for those of us who are not part of the CEU, probably CEU was even more important than for those that have been in. Because in a strange way, for the last especially 10 years, what happened was that Central Europe stopped to be as important as it was. The world moved, the world became bigger. We wanted to talk about our region, but at the same time, we didn't want to go provincial and parochial, and we easily can do this. And I do believe that CEU was very important providing this constructive tension between interest in the region and much more global view, and basically not just saying our own story and repeating our own story, especially when there is no audience for it anyway. So this is why I'm very grateful, and on behalf of these people whom you don't know but who know you, I want to congratulate you for the 20th anniversary. And then saying all this, basically also you have a nice symmetry. You have a Pole, also you should have a Bulgarian, because the Poles are presenting the historic and kind of heroic optimism when it comes to the difficult times, we Bulgarians are presenting a cheerful pessimism. So as a representative of the school of the cheerful pessimism, I do believe that one of the major problems that we're going to face as an intellectual community in the decade to come is that in a strange way, the very obvious and 20 years ago not much discussed relations between democracy and open society are going to be now very much contested and put under question. Because something very simple and at the same time very complex has happened. Democracy now is an uncontested concept on the level of political ideology. If Popper is going to write a book today, it's not going to be open society and its enemies, it's going to be open society and its doubles. Because everybody claims to be democracy on open society, but under the institutional arrangements of democracy, you have regimes which are less open than you could expect. And at the same time, democracy is very triumphant all over. At the same time, there is a major idea of a crisis of democracy which can fill at the very center of Western societies, and this not only Central and Eastern Europe. I do believe you can very strongly feel it in Western Europe. You can feel it in the United States. Funny enough, people started to remember some of the criticism towards democracy that have been so famous in Europe in the 1920s and 1930s. And don't forget, it was not anybody else but Winston Churchill who said that the strongest argument against democracy is a five-minute talk with an average voter. I'm saying this because I can imagine this is going to be very popular with some people in Brussels these days. I'm saying this, and I'll start to make a very short presentation in the problem I see it, starting with a novel, which probably you have read, probably not, but I do believe it's a good introduction on the state of political in Europe today. It's a novel called Seeing by the Portuguese author and Nobel Prize winner Saramago, and it starts with a nice plot. In an unnamed country, on the day of the elections, like an epidemic, 72% of the population vote with the blank ballots. The government and the opposition are totally shocked. They don't know what to do. Nothing illegal has happened, but 72% of the people vote with the blank ballot. So then the government decided to repeat the elections, and then 83% of the people voted with the blank ballot. The government started thinking about conspiracy, they start interrogating people, but they cannot understand exactly what they're investigating. Nothing illegal happened. Then the government decided to punish the population. They left the city so people can understand how difficult it is to live without a government. And nothing happened. By the way, this was much more before Belgium managed to embody this anyway. I'm seeing this because my major argument is going to be the following. There were five important transformations, I'm going to call them even small revolutions that happened in the Western world in the last 40 years, which so much deepened the democratization of our societies, but at the same time, these five, seven small revolutions probably are also at the roots of the present crisis in the way we see it. The first is the revolution of the 1960s, the lifestyle revolutions that put individual at the center of politics. This was the revolution that also brought human rights at the center of the agenda. But as the result of this new individualism, collective action became very problematic in Western democracies. We have studies in Bulgaria showing that the most active people, they are very eager to sue the government, but they are not very eager to vote for it. You have this type of a new activism which is very individualistic in its right, and it's much more based on the idea of the consumer rights than on anything else. The second revolution that was extremely important for the spread of democracy was the market revolution of the 1980s. But at the same time, while spreading democracy, the idea of the market revolution and the way it has been interpreted very much destroyed the idea of a public interest and public good. People were convinced that it is enough to pursue their private interest in a legal way, and public interest is going to emerge on its own. And it appeared to be a very important fallacy in a way. And the third revolution was 1989, which managed to marry 1960s and 1980s in a very happily way, but we made out of a democracy the idea of a natural state of society, and we started to behave as if when there is no authoritarianism, nothing else than democracy is possible. And I do believe that in a way we lost part of our curiosity how our societies functioned. If you see how normative we became, even if you see how much our studies have been concentrated on institutions and how much we lost interest how people feel, we lost interest on democratic experience, being very much discussing only democratic institutions. I do believe that from this point of view, something that was so important also contributed to the crisis that we see now. And the fourth small revolutions I want to touch on was the communication revolution, internet. On one level, internet helped a lot for people to participate, to have new sources of information, but if you go closer, you're going to see that also the internet revolution very much contributed to the fragmentation of the public space. Yes, normally we have get all the sources of information that we want, but as a rule, we always go with the same sources of information, and normally, this is the type of the information that share our biases. As a result of it, our society became much more ghettoized than much more open. And I do believe also these new discoveries in the brain sciences that managed to convince political consultants that what matters is manipulating emotions and not having a rational debate. This is very important. In a certain way, Karl Rove appeared to be more important for the political consultants than Karl Popper, and the deliberative nature of democracy was very much put under question. I'm saying on this, and this is my last point, I do believe that intellectually, we're in a crossing point in which it's not simply to talk that democracy goes this way and others. We are not describing pathology. We are describing the new state of democracy. And probably as a result of it, universities are going to matter more, because it's going to be a time also for intellectual activism to try to get things right. And getting things right from a certain point of view is more difficult than doing things right, because doing things right can happen also by accident. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ivan. Let me now introduce our third speaker, Aryeh Neier, who's a human rights activist who has investigated human rights abuses around the world in more than 40 countries. After serving as the national director of the American Civil Liberties Union, he became the co-founder and executive director of Human Rights Watch, the international NGO that is known for protecting human rights and for documenting violations of the laws of war. By issuing a call for its establishment, Aryeh also played a crucial role in the creation of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. Since its foundation in 1993, he has been the president of the Open Society Institute, Open Society Foundation. Aryeh's leadership at OSF developed the institute into a highly prestigious, worldwide known organization promoting democratic governments, human rights, and the development of civil society organizations in transition countries. Aryeh.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to have an opportunity to participate in this occasion and to congratulate the Central European University on its first 20 years. The establishment of the Central European University was inspired to a large extent by the revolutions in this part of the world in 1989. And I think from the standpoint of open society globally, the most important thing that has happened since then is the Arab revolutions of 2011. I think it's worth pointing out some differences between the Arab revolutions of 2011 and the East European revolutions of 1989. Of course, the East European revolutions, in a geopolitical sense, were more important because they were instrumental in bringing an end to the Cold War. But the Arab revolutions of 2011 have their own distinctive significance. One element of them is that, in contrast to the East European revolutions of 1989, they were not aimed at liberation from a colonial power. There is no equivalent of the Soviet Union that contributed to the repression in the Arab countries. In the Arab countries, it is a revolution against their own governments, and not only against an imperial system. I think another difference between what is taking place today and what took place in 1989 is that in 1989, the United States in particular had succeeded in conveying the view that economic prosperity and political freedom went hand in hand. And I think that link is by no means as strong today and may have been severed entirely today. The economic rise of China during a period in which it has maintained its authoritarian system, and in the last two or three years has even tightened its authoritarian system, and the difficulty that the Western democracies have had in recovering from the economic crisis have, I think, broken the tie or the relationship between economic prosperity and political freedom. I think when people in the Arab countries struggle for political freedom, it's difficult for them to assume that an inevitable consequence will be greater economic prosperity. And then I think a third aspect of the revolutions in the Arab countries that seems to me distinctive is particularly illustrated by what is taking place today in Syria. In Syria, we have the example of an unarmed population struggling for political freedom in circumstances in which the government is willing to use any level of force in order to crush the revolution. And despite its unrestrained use of force, it has not so far been able to suppress the revolution. We did not have any analogy to Syria in Eastern Europe in 1989. I think the significance of the Arab revolutions for the cause of open society globally is that it suggests that people in any part of the world are willing to risk a great deal, in many cases, risk everything in order to live in a more open society. And clearly, open society isn't the only driving force of the Arab revolutions. I think revulsion against corruption by the head of state and the family of the head of state has been a significant factor in the Arab revolutions of 2011. But clearly, political freedom, an end to emergency rule, an end to political detention, an end to the widespread use of torture, the suppression of free media, these are central factors in the Arab revolutions. I was asked to say something about the importance of Europe with respect to the struggle for open society worldwide, and I want to focus on the importance of Europe with respect to the Arab revolutions. It seems to me that it is immensely important that Europe should try to play an influential role with respect to the Arab revolutions. For one thing, the United States, which was willing to assume the mantle of global leadership over a prolonged period, seems to me less willing to do that today than it has been in previous times. And even if it were willing to assume the mantle of global leadership, I'm not sure how well accepted it would be in the Arab countries. Europe has an opportunity, but there are some things that Europe has to do if it is to exercise that opportunity. And I will mention two things. One is, of course, the question of the accession of Turkey to the European Union. If Europe reneges on the accession of a large Muslim state to the European Union, it cannot be helpful in terms of relations with the countries in which the Arab revolutions are taking place. And so Europe's role with Turkey seems to me a crucial issue. And the other obvious question is the rise of racism and xenophobia in Europe. In this region, racism and xenophobia is primarily manifested with respect to the Roma minority, but in Western Europe, including traditionally liberal countries such as the Netherlands, Denmark, Sweden, and Finland, the rise of xenophobia and racism is directed particularly against the Muslim minorities in those countries. The way in which the strangers among us are treated in any country, the way that migrants are treated, the way in which the struggle for national identity seems to imply for some people that they need to act against those of different identity is disabling so far as Europe's ability to have an influence that is positive with respect to the Arab Revolution. So the role of Europe in promoting open society worldwide can be an immensely important role. The ideas of open society were principally developed in Europe, and Europe ought to be the exponent of the ideas of open society. But the way Europe conducts itself, both in terms of its relations with others and the way it conducts itself internally, I think is inevitably going to determine whether Europe is capable of playing the positive role with respect to open society globally that I hope it would play. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It was interesting to see how our panelists were touching on some of the same questions. Aryeh was calling attention to the important role of Europe in promoting the cause of open society, and one of Wanda's questions was who in Europe going to safeguard the values of liberal democracy when Europe is preoccupied in an economic crisis. So I was wondering if our three panelists would like to have a follow-up on each other's remarks, and they would like to add something to what's been said.
Please.
I think the reflecting on the Arab Revolution, I think that one very, very important factor is that people were willing to sacrifice their lives for a common cause. And that's a memory, that's a historic event in those countries. And it will change the culture, the political culture in those countries in a way that is, in my opinion, not reversible. So the revolutions generally, or rather one would say, revolutions rarely succeed. They start off with great enthusiasm, euphoria, and they end in tears, very often terror or repressive regime. But the fact that they have occurred then change the behavior of that country afterwards. So reflecting on the revolution in Hungary, 1956, which was repressed, but it carried then the seeds of the democratic transition after 1989. So I have similar hopes for the Arab Revolution.
Uh,
Ivan, I wanted to comment, or as we say, build on your five revolutions and add a little couple of sides to it. When you talked about the internet revolution, that internet revolution is going hand in hand with the death of traditional newspapers. Now, in representative democracy, it was the serious, the so-called opinion-making newspapers that have sort of created a switchboard, information switchboard between the government and the governed. They helped understand, they were also critical, they were the watchdogs, you know, with better or worse teeth as the case might be, but still the watchdogs, etc., etc. It seems now that this era may be coming to the end, although, you know, I'm really not in the business of predicting the future. There's no dividend in that business. But this period of mediation and explanation is over. So that's one side. And the other side, and it may be connected, I don't know, I'm not a political scientist, but it there also seems to be we seem to be facing a limit to representative democracy. Something has happened on the way to the Agora. You know, you talked about the fact that the individualism, part of the individualism is democracy combined with the free market gives people a choice to pursue their private lives. Problem is, it's a choice. Right? It's very few people actually choose public sphere now, at least among the good and the young. And there seems to be such a space now between politicians and the people. Such a dislike. I mean, if we look at the numbers, nobody trusts, I mean, whatever the country, nobody trusts the elected officials, nobody trusts the government as in administrations, I mean, nobody trusts the institutions of the state. Something about participative democracy, you know, in other words, we need to start going to restaurants less and to Agora more. You know, in the dusk hours, you know, greater involvement, direct involvement, whether it's in the form of local funds, et cetera, and, you know, people having local oversight over local administrations to fight corruption on a very local level, et cetera, et cetera. So it seems to me that, I mean, I don't want to enlarge your list from five to seven, just, you know, little sides. Thank you.
Thank you very much. First, I'll be very happy to enlarge it. And I very much is going to agree, because at least in my view, the problem which we really face is that what we love is also what we should fear. In 1960s, especially after 68, there was the major question, can democratic institutions be effective if society is not democratic enough? And basically, we have been answering this question for 30 years. Probably now we are facing different questions. Is there a certain level of democratization of society that makes it ungovernable? And I do believe this is a real question. This is not kind of a rhetorical question. And just one also comment on, in my view, very important parallel between the revolutions of 1989 and 2011. Just after 2011, when we all saw on television people on the street and people starting to compare, for one, it was just 1989 being repeated by Arabs born in 1989. For others, it was the Arab version of 1848. But for me, there is much more important aspect of this revolution. see how European societies, and I mean both West Europeans and East Europeans, reacted to the change. And in a certain way, the impact of the Arab revolutions on the European societies, nevertheless that it was not European revolutions, can be as profound as 1989 was. Because what I saw, and I hope I'm wrong, what I saw in Europe is how demographic imagination defeated the democratic imagination. For 20 years, it was the democratic imagination, how we can change the world, that was the leading one. And now, basically, it's the demographic imagination, the fear of the immigrants, the fear how others are going to change us. And I do believe from this point of view, for Europe, and I agree very much with Ari on this, the next decade is going to be make or break decade, because this is also about the political identity of Europe. And some questions that I do believe we hoped that are solved, probably these questions are going to come back.
I want to comment on one aspect of Wanda's talk. Wanda, you, I think, very powerfully captured one of the real destructive forces that's at work, which is the demons of history. You said the demons of history are still alive and can be used by cynical politicians. And I think this is very clear, but needs to be understood in the context of our university as well as, and by that I don't mean the history of the university, but I mean the study of history at the university. Some of us in this room have had direct experience with what the demons of history have done in this region, particularly in the former Yugoslavia, where cynical politicians will take hold of particular ways in which history is being projected, particularly in this case, some of the ancient battles that were fought against the Turks in Kosovo, and we'll use that to stimulate ethnic conflict against those who are sort of latter-day successors of the Turks in that respect. I make this point only to underscore the importance of the study of history at Central European University. I'm known as a champion of the School of Public Policy and the connection between practice and theory and some of the new elements that we're pursuing, network science, cognitive science, et cetera. But I am an even deeper believer in the importance of getting history right. And I think we have a particular role to play at Central European University in that respect. And in that respect, it's very good that we have such strong historians distinguished in the fields of medieval studies and history. Across Europe and in the United States, history is being essentially defunded in some respects in the university. There are cuts that are being made, and there are focal points in other areas that are more exciting and that look more toward the future. But I think our exploration of the past at CEU is one of the most important aspects of what we do. And there are public policy implications in this respect, which are obvious. So I think that this is one of the core elements of our university, George, and it's often not perceived in a very public way, but it's an extremely important element. And thank you, Wanda, for bringing that point. I think, unless there are other comments that anyone wants to make among the panelists, Wanda, you do.
I just wanted to, I'm sorry to take up so much oxygen, but I wanted to add one more thing to Aryeh's list of differences between the two revolutions. I think it is important to remember that Central Europe had a very strong and long tradition of anti-communist opposition organized, underground civil society, underground newspapers. This was important. These people okay, they were shot at maybe in 56 in Poznań, they were shot at in 71 in 17 Gdańsk and several other occasions, but mostly they just went to jail. Which gave them time to read books, including books on economics, on how to run local governments, etc., etc. I won't say, it would be an exaggeration to say that they were prepared to govern after June 4th of 89 when we had the free elections in Poland, but they were less unprepared to govern than, let's say, the rebels, the revolutionaries in Tahrir Square. And that's very important when we try to kind of count probabilities of success.
Just one comment. You mentioned the underground newspapers, and of course in Poland in particular, the underground press was immensely important. I think at one time there may have been as many as 400 different underground publications that were appearing regularly, and that certainly contributed to the and played a major role in the revolution in Poland. There was not an equivalent of that in the case of the Arab revolutions, and I think there is today tendency to attribute the organizing for the Arab revolutions to the contemporary social media. But I actually think there was a much more important medium that played a role in the Arab revolutions, and that was Al Jazeera. Al Jazeera has had an enormous impact in that region. And it gave people a great deal of information about the abuses committed by their own governments in the region. And I think that was, it's hard to imagine these revolutions without the influence of Al Jazeera.
We're now going to move to a second aspect of this conference, and as I've said, we are very fortunate to have my four predecessors as rector of the university here, and the way we're going to do this is I'm going to invite each of them in turn to come to the podium and speak for about 5 minutes, and hopefully at the end of that period, we will also have time for some additional discussion and questions, but it needs obviously no saying, but it's certainly worth saying that what this university is today is the product of the four people that we're going to be hearing from, in addition to many, many others, above all our founder, and certainly the faculty and students who've come through the university during this period. But I know what it's like to sit in a particular seat and have to try to make decisions with many constituencies for the university. So the four people that I'm going to introduce now have done this, and they've done it in tumultuous times. They've been part of your revolution, George, and they've tried in their own way to steer it. So I'm personally very grateful to each of them, and I will introduce them as they take the podium. The first person I want to introduce is Bill Newton Smith, who was the first chair of the executive committee of CEU and a participant in the Dubrovnik meeting that you spoke about, George. He has been since 1970 a Fairfax Fellow and the lecturer in philosophy of science at Balliol College at Oxford. I learned recently that Bill was arrested and spent time in Czechoslovakia in 1980 in an effort to spend time 48 hours, I think, under arrest before he was expelled from the country. In an effort to bring books and help underground universities that were developing at that time. So this is a heroic initial act that introduced Bill Newton Smith to the region and to the principles of open society. So Bill, if you could come join us by taking the podium and giving us your reflections. Thank you very much.
Five minutes? Everyone knows that a lecture takes 55 minutes. But of course, if I say each sentence in half the time I say the preceding one, 2 minutes will be enough. I thought it might be appropriate to reflect on some of the activities of the Executive Committee in the very early days of the CEU. I'm going to look at a couple of aspects that relate to our theme, because our theme really has two dimensions. Is the CEU itself an embodiment of open society values? And how does or how can the CEU contribute to building and sustaining open societies? Of course, as a philosopher, I'm deeply distressed that nobody on the panel has said what an open society is. But, you know, my quick way of dealing with this is to give a list of attributes. I don't think I can give an essence. I mean, some people have tried to use fallibility as the basis of grounding a conception of open society, and you can get some way, as John Stuart Mill showed in On Liberty. So I would say an open society has to be democratic in the electoral sense, has adherence to the rule of law, strong civic institutions of diverse kinds, exhibits what I call tolerance plus. It's not just tolerant, but positively enjoys diversity of ethnicity, religion, culture, etc. And it values engaged citizenry, that is, citizens interested in and capable of using rational discourse as a method of settling social issues. So that's what I mean by an open society. In the early days, we had much debate. The first 2 years was, you know, what subjects should we teach? Should the Open Society Institute be a department of the university? I mean, just think how things would be different if we decided that the way we didn't decide it. But of course, the most lively debate was, are we going to have a president or are we going to have a rector? This went on through interminable meetings and drove me to distraction. Of course, it wasn't just a debate about the name. It was a debate between those who thought of an American university and those who thought of a continental university. But it was cloaked into simple, what will we call him? Well, one day I hit upon the solution. I'd spent enough time in Britain that I knew about a British compromise. So I approached the committee and I said, we're going to have both a rector and a president. I said, yes, we'll have a president because we'll have a chief executive officer. And we'll have a rector because we'll have a chair of the Senate. Oh, but they'll be the same person. And in doing so, it's possible that I foreclosed an opportunity for the CEU to move even closer to the ideal of an open society university, because an interesting argument to be had here that it may be in an open society university ideally constituted, the faculty should have more direct control over the governance than they do in a situation where the same person is the president and the chairman of the Senate. So, if so, I apologize to the faculty for having foreclosed a chance to make the university more open by this nomenclature move. I'm not proposing a change. If things aren't broken, we shouldn't fix them. And I know that one of the reasons universities survive is that they're difficult to change. We made our decision, it's working, we'll stick with it. It's just, I like to speculate on what might have happened if we decided between rector and president rather than consolidating them into the... It's impossible to change universities once they get going, as Leon has heard me say. You know, once the university gets going, the question becomes, why is it right to make any changes now? And in Oxford, we divide the faculty into the radicals and the conservatives. The conservatives are opposed to change on principle. The radicals consider each particular proposal for change and vote against it on its demerits. So, but I think the university is doing quite well as embodying open society values. The other issue, how many minutes have I got left?
I'd say one or two.
One, okay, oh, good heavens. You know, we had a huge debate about what subjects. In those days, the subjects studied had to be relevant to the transition. So the economists come in and say, privatization, you need us. The historians come in and say, now we can tell the real history as it was, you need us. So we go through, and I'm thinking, what am I going to do? I'm a philosopher. I want my subject in this university. But, I mean, you know, if they have problems about whether they perhaps we're brains in a vat being fed sensation as of an external world that doesn't really exist, I got a lot to say about that. But what has that to do with the transition? What has the interpretation of Gödel's theorem to do with the transition? So, I didn't do anything. I thought, I haven't got any arguments as to why we should do philosophy. And we reached the point where there was room for one more subject, and I'm still thinking, how can I do this? How can I do this? In comes medieval history with an amazing argument that no one can remember about how medieval history was relevant to the political transition. And so they filled the slot, the last slot we could afford to have. So I apologize to the philosophers that my failure to advance the subject meant that it took several more years before philosophy rightfully took its place at the CU. Of course, if I'd known about the concept of open society, I would have done better. Because crucially, in the ingredient of the open society, as I've defined it, is an engaged citizenry who believe in critical debate and discussion. And some subjects we do at the CU contribute directly to issues of policy. Other subjects contribute indirectly through cultivating the style of reasoning that's important for the engaged citizenry in debating in rational ways. And that's, I think, the claim of philosophy. So I would have been better if I'd had the concept of the open society foremost rather than the concept of transition. But, all right, 5 minutes is 5 minutes.
So our second rector, really our first president and rector under the new regime that was unveiled by the executive committee of Bill Newton Smith, our first president and rector was Al Stepan, and he served from 1994 to 1996. He came to CEU from the deanship of the School of Public and International Affairs at Columbia University, so clearly CEU had done extremely well in recruiting him. During his term, CEU gained the legal status in the U.S. and in Hungary, so that was a great achievement, and in many respects began to realize the questions and dreams of the Dubrovnik meeting, the accreditation of various programs, the move into a permanent premises in Budapest, the development of a financial structure. So I'm particularly grateful to you, Al, for all that you did then, as all of us are. So over to you.
Thank you very much, John. It's obviously a great pleasure and honored to be here at this celebration of and reflection about CEU at 20. Here are a few of my pretty simple things I like to celebrate. When I greeted the first full CEU class in October 1993, I was a bit worried that the most I could offer them when they completed their studies of CEU was a certificate of attendance and a handshake, because we didn't have one of our departments that was accredited, and we simply could not give a degree. I thus am obviously immensely delighted that since then, 7,428 students have received degrees, 316 of them doctoral degrees, and that they've come from more than 100 different countries. Now, what we're talking about, building networks, this is one of the most important networks we've created, is this fellowship, and I think it's actually a moral and ethical community in many places, where people reflect upon, and we have all these honorable alumni, or people in the area that Chris talked about. It's crucial, that Ivan said, that it's crucial people like it, and they know it, and it's important. I also celebrate CEU's research success. All of the original group And I taught a first course, one of the first courses in the summer of 1991. Especially our founder, George Soros, insisted that we were in Europe and should rapidly attempt to establish ourselves as an intellectually competitive and valued member of European Union's university system. Now, for a new university, this has been done by my successors, who will speak after me, amazingly rapidly and successfully. So far, George mentioned two of the CEU-funded research projects. I went through the records recently. George, we've had 60 at CEU, 60, which you or I never thought for a second could ever happen. 60 CEU-funded research projects. At the moment, there are about 23 of them going. This, by the way, is extremely high if we're looking at the amount of research projects that are funded by the 10 countries of the former Soviet Union, I mean, former post-communist countries that are now in the European Union. So it's great success. Now, one of the reasons for this success was the fact that our original model was close to the model that, to some extent, the European Union is trying to create now. And this is basically Erasmus Mundus. The Erasmus Mundus competition has its problem-solving research, and I think all of our research should be problem-solving, a major problem of our time, and conducted by two or more different universities in two or more different states. Now, this is precisely as a model, partly because we are so small. The average top 20 department in the United States is somewhere between 40 to 80 people. All our departments started out as 7. We couldn't possibly, as a department, be competitive. But we could, as a group, be competitive if we chose a problem well. So to some extent, CEU's original base, and George always said he liked the medieval wandering scholar. Go where the problem is. Meet your other colleagues. This has been reinvented by the European Union in the Erasmus Mundus idea, and we're part of it. Matter of fact, we're the exemplar of it. Another major original goal was to avoid contributing to brain drain. We wanted our CEU graduates to retain and help construct open societies in their own countries. However, we're frankly very worried, all of us, that given that students would have greatly improved English and a degree that eventually had a real American dimension, that these people could be lost to the region. And when I asked for the figures on this recently, I was really cheered. It's higher than George, you expected, or Bill Newton Smith or I had expected at the time, and it's terrific. Basically, 70% of all of our CEU graduates are living in their countries where they came from, and we hope that was a choice. They could have gone elsewhere. It was a choice to be morally and politically present in the creation of their universities. That's great. It's actually higher than that. Another 15% are in the region. Okay. Finally, I celebrate that CEU, despite our youth, has already emerged as a teaching, research, and institution-building model for new democracies. I just returned from my second visit to Egypt and Tunisia since the Arab revolutions. At a major conference on failed, it's very important to look at failed transitions and successful transitions, 4 of the 8 major speakers there turn out to all have profound and deep CEU roots. Academic rector Laszlo Bruce was one of the key people. Philippe Smitter, who teaches a sequence here, is one of the key people. David Stark, who came here for 10 years in a row, and myself, all have taught at CEU and feel we're members of CEU. So we were about half of the discussants. Now, at this meeting, what was fascinating is the question of CEU kept coming up. The need of something like a CEU, not just a good university, but a good university with a purpose, a good university that's committed to certain problems, privileges problems, and privileges thinking about them. So in that sense, they wanted to know how they can have better connections with CEU, and I'll talk with John about this. They're desperate to have some more of the students come, and they're desperate to take a look at your curriculum. I'll say, by the way, that of the 15 major works in democratization, not one has been translated into Arab. I got someone to do that just last week, but so that will be done. But this huge amount of the ideas of political society, they have terrifically robust and creative civil society, resistance against an authoritarian regime. But in contrast to Poland, Chile, Korea, they almost have no development so far of what I call political society that will have to create the constitutions, institutions, and political parties of a democracy. And CEU has a lot of that, so you can help a lot. Now, the connection between CEU and the Arab Spring will continue to develop for all sorts of reasons. The Egyptian-American star of the movie, The Kite Runner, returned to participate in Tahrir Square and help make the revolution, but also to film it. I saw him last week, and he came up to me and he said, "Can you help me? Do you know any place or anybody who's created a great archive of resistance to authoritarianism, a great archive about human rights, and it's really accessible for teachers and researchers?" I said, "Yes. The best one in the world was created by Ishvan Rev, and it's open, and he would love to talk with you, and it's the Open Society Archive that was developed into this great combination of OSI and CEU, which is absolutely distinctive, and then the HESP, our Higher Educational Society. This combination is nowhere else, and it's great. Thank you."
We will hear from Joseph Yajap, who is the second rector of CEU, president and rector, and came to CEU from Palatsky University in the Czech Republic, where he was the rector and where he is now teaching again. I got to know Joseph when I was living in Czech Republic during the time when he was serving as CEU rector, and that's how I first heard about CEU and got to know it. And during his tenure, the enrollment increased dramatically. New curricula were introduced and launched. Partnerships with European universities were established, and the Alumni Affairs Office was created. So, Joseph, we're very honored to have you here with us today, too.
Thank you, John. Well, my wholehearted congratulations, of course, to the founder of the university and to everybody who has been involved in this project, in this very successful project, indeed. I came here in the winter of 1997 after, as it was mentioned already, having worked on the transformation of an inherited university from the previous regime, when indeed we knew, or we thought we knew, what we did not want, but we did not know really very much what we wanted in 1989, in 1990. And me being the very first freely elected rector in Czechoslovakia, I sort of had to think twice, three times, where do we start? I remember when I asked my colleagues, what does it mean, really, academic freedom? What would it practically be in our situation? And practically nobody remembered what it could have been from the First Republic. So we were sort of guessing, and this guessing went on and on. Now, it was already mentioned twice here that there is a difference between the transformation and building, creating a university. When I came here to Budapest, to Central European University, we were creating a university. I remember dealing with the chairman of the accreditation committee, Professor Ronatáš, with the same results, unfortunately, as the negotiations with the chairman of the Accreditation Commission went on in Prague. They were not convinced enough that this is an academic institution that could get accreditation. So accreditation we had to seek because, as George mentioned, in the beginning he thought that we do not need the university as an institution, but then we found out that we do indeed, because students need a paper that shows their qualification, and we wanted to show that there is a possibility of building a different spirit of an institution of higher learning. And that is what started here. I remember some of those building blocks where sort of we, during my time, tried to institutionalize the Central European University, establishing, for instance, the alumni office, which was, I think, a very important thing, because to talk to about Central European University, I may remember and rely on my memories, but I like especially to talk to graduates from Central European University who are, and are quite a few, at my university in Olomouc, where I came back to teach, and they are among the most bright, the brightest people, young people, leading sort of, let's say, reforms into the second stage. Reforms in the history department, Mr. Erbil is the head of it, reforms in bringing in globalized, international, cosmopolitan spirit from the Erasmus Mundus program that the university is part of. And again, it is graduates from Central European University that are in the foreground of all those organizations and all those efforts. Now, I believe, well, yes, it was alumni office. Then, of course, we also started to bring the university to the international context. I remember we introduced it to the Association of European Universities, which does not give you really the accreditation yet, but some recognition from partner institutions. We then, however, needed in 97 and 98, we needed to prepare the accreditation for all of the programs that were taught at Middle States in the United States. And it came later, it was a lot of work, and it came after I was gone, and I will never forget the collegial generosity of my follower, Yehuda Elkana, who said, look, Joseph, you have done all the work, or you have done a lot of work, you know, why don't you come and announce that we got the accreditation? This is something quite unusual in the academic world, indeed. So thanks once again. And I was very proud and very happy that it did happen. I would say that teaching now a course on Central Europe, I think that, and we still believe and see that it is a very vague term, vague in terms of where does it start, where does it end, what is included, what is not included, what period, etc., etc., what characteristics. I would say that the existence of Central European University added some new contents to the term Central Europe. And I think that in itself is a great, great achievement. I would like to add one probably very private sort of thought. When the School for Public Policy was mentioned here as something as a, of a base for the larger network, my question, and this is a very private question, is could the Central European University, through either the School of Public Policy or maybe through all the courses that are being taught, do something that would improve the position of a minority in Europe that is still discriminated and very much marginalized, the Roma people. And it would be wonderful if graduates from this university would be automatically or could be automatically taken for someone who would try to help the situation, to solve the situation, which is not seeing much progress so far. Well, let me wish Central European University and all the students, all the professors, all the people who work here many, many more successful years, decades. Indeed, a Central European University has changed the situation in higher education in not only Central Europe, or former Eastern Europe, but in Europe at large. Congratulations and thank you.
It now gives me a great deal of pleasure to introduce my predecessor, the person who, from whom I learned a great deal about CEU when I came, and who did an enormous amount over the decade that he served as president and rector, Yehuda Elkanah. Yehuda came to CEU from the Swiss Institute of Technology in Zurich, where he was professor of the theory of science. During his decade as rector, there's an enormous list of things that were accomplished. I'll just mention the most dramatic and important. He really, I think, transformed the departments, the collection of departments that we had at CEU into a real university with a long-term strategic vision. He strengthened CEU's reputation as a research-intensive university, graduate institution. He developed first-rate faculty. He made more than 100 new appointments. He established, I think, four new departments, if I'm not correct. You can correct me, Yehuda. He more than doubled CEU's student enrollment, and he reinforced the mission of CEU as a dynamic and transnational university that stimulates creative and critical thinking. Today, Yehuda is a fellow of the Wissenschaftskolleg in Berlin and does many other things which he will no doubt describe to you. So, Yehuda, please come to the podium and give us your thoughts. He never got it. He never got it. I knew I couldn't persuade him to go to the podium.
Okay. I don't like to speak from lectern, as I asked for it, but he's doing funny things. Can somebody do something about it? Okay. Congratulations to the CEU community for its past achievements and best wishes for continued success, which this university and this community deserves. Having said that, I would like to use a few minutes in three theses. Thesis one. Universities have and will have a growing central role in educating the next generations to prevent the slippage that Wanda was talking about, and hopefully to educate generations which will indeed be capable of a civil society as we understand it. And universities are central, will remain central. Second thesis is that the task of the university is not educating for the workforce. The task of the university is to educate concerned citizens for a democratic, liberal, egalitarian, open civil society. This is universally correct for all universities, but this is something which I'd like to emphasize especially for two countries which I'm connected, Israel and Hungary. In both countries, democracy and open society are under severe threat nowadays. The third thesis has to do with the question how to achieve this, how to educate concerned citizens. And concerned citizens, I mean not only a moral, it has a moral aspect, but I mean a cognitive aspect. To educate concerned citizens, universities, indeed societies, have to abandon our cherished Enlightenment values and replace them by the new Enlightenment. And this needs explanation, I know. The great scholars of the 18th, 19th, 20th centuries, but especially at the beginning, knew very well that the world is messy and complex. But they decided to create knowledge as if it would not have been so. They decided to create knowledge as if the world had been predictable, universal theories, reductionist, linear, context independent, and you can name a whole list of things, on which the Enlightenment values of knowledge were built. For 300 years, these attitudes and values indeed created an unprecedented success in knowledge in all areas: natural sciences, social sciences, humanity, and all of them. This started breaking down in the last 100 years. We now must take into account in our teaching and in our universities, indeed in society at large, that the world is indeed complex and messy. And therefore, we have to create knowledge which is not universalistic, rather local universals moving to global contextualism, a world of knowledge which takes into account that the world is not predictable, not linear, not reducible, not on a whole series of things, embracing contradictions, and only this kind of attitude will be able to educate those concerned citizens on the cognitive level that I think modern society, in order to become an open and democratic society, genuinely needs. This is a tall order, but in addition to really create high-level research, we must reform the curricula, undergraduate and graduate, in this spirit, and this is a task for the whole world. Unfortunately, this is my last remark on that, while hundreds, if not thousands, of new universities are being in India and China, they blindly copy the curricula of the Western world without realizing what an enormous disaster that is. Moving from local universals to global contextuals, it's not relativism, but it's an issue which takes into account that the world is indeed complex and messy, and we have to cope with it. Thank you.
Well, I think we have explored CEU and the Open Society for a little more than 2 hours. I think at heart, the one thought I want to leave with you is something that I don't think has yet been said, but it has been implied by all the speakers, which is that this is a great risk-taking adventure that CEU is on. It's not surprising that our founder is one of the great risk takers in his public activities in terms of reaching beyond the conventional and starting a revolution, in this case a revolution that was an educational revolution and that has now created a university of the kind that we have been talking about for the last 2 hours. So, this is really at heart and at bottom a risk-taking venture, and for that reason I want to leave you with one small philosopher's story. Our philosophy department is well represented among our executive committee originally and now, of course, in the leadership of the university. The great Plato scholar F.M. Cornford wrote a book, a little book at one point, which Bill, you may know, which is called a Guide to the for the Young Academic Politician. And he did this after serving for a number of years, I think, as the master or maybe even a higher level at Oxford. And he found how difficult it was to get anything done and how difficult it was to make any changes, so he decided to write this book. And at the core of the book is a chapter called The Principle of the Dangerous Precedent. And in the book, in the chapter, he goes through all the arguments that he's ever heard about why it's very important that a university not ever set a dangerous precedent within its own confines, because that might then guide the equally non-risk-taking future leaders, you know, in a way that would establish another dangerous precedent. So the bottom line of his story is that, as he said and he encountered in all of his work in university administration, and I quote him, "Nothing should ever be done for the first time," which is what the principle of the dangerous precedent is. So I want to congratulate our founder, all the members of this panel, above all for me, the former rectors, and all of you who are major participants in this enterprise, this risk-taking enterprise, for constantly creating dangerous precedents. And may we go forth and do more of this. I will conclude by inviting you to please come downstairs to a reception and a fulsome amount of food that you might be able to consider for your dinner, if that's what you wish. But above all, to thank all of you for coming, to thank all of the members of our panel and all the former rectors. So please join us downstairs. Thank you. Thank you.